Hello, beautiful people around the web. I'm SnickersHD and I'm your host for today's video. Today's topic is the scout in MvM. I give you a basic guide and tutorial. I basically add some advanced stuff there as well, just for you to have an overview over the whole concept as how to play a scout. There are many different ways, but I present you my way to do that and which you can perfectly adapt and then be fine and no one will ever complain. If that is your wish, then just follow my instructions and have fun. Alright, let's just jump right into action. I cover the upgrades now. As scout, you want to have the movement speed and jump height first on the maximum level. Upgrade it as soon as possible and to the maximum. If there is a giant super scout on the first wave as well, go for a maximum movement speed and once the slowing on the mad milk. It is important sometimes for a team just to have that one mad milk out to slow down the enemy robot, but go for movement speed and jump height first in general. The reasoning behind that is quite simple. Movement speed allows you to get to money faster and jump height allows you to be more mobile. You can get around certain situations faster and take shortcuts which you generally couldn't take. After you have covered that, you want to get your mad milk up at least to the movement speed reduction if you haven't done this already, or if there is no super scout in the next upcoming waves, you just generally go for the resistances. Most of the time you need the crit resistance first, because that is something that I had to realize after playing quite a lot. Listen up how the crit resistance work. When you upgrade the resistances in general, you absorb the base damage. And if you upgrade the crit resistance, you absorb the crit damage. There is a difference between crit damage and base damage. If there is a rocket incoming, it hits you for, let's say, 200 damage in total. And just by the way, I make up these numbers, but it is just for the visualization, basically. Now, when this rocket with 200 damage hits you, and it deals 50 base damage and 150 damage with a crit, and you upgrade the crit resistance, you get only the crit resistance, which means that you take full damage on the base damage, which is 50, but you take just 10% with the full upgrade on the 150 damage, which equals out to 65 damage in total. When you now eat this crit rocket for 200 damage, but with the standard resistances on blast resistance, for instance, you absorb just 75% of the base damage, which is 75% of 50 damage, and you still get the full crits, which is 150 damage. So if there is something that can crit you, go always for the crit resistance first, because you don't want to get that one shot if you are low on HP for some reasons. And just one side note here, please do never upgrade fire resistance as a scout. It's simply wasted money. You could have gone for maybe the crit resistance, which is exactly the same amount of money, or for damage upgrades. Whatever, it wouldn't make sense to go for the fire resistance because there are so few instances where you could need it. Now, when you are done with the upgrades for the movement speed, jump height, and the basic resistances, which is just the crit resistance, you go for the full upgrade on the mad milk. The mad milk basically is a projectile that you toss at enemies to make them being coated with milk, which makes everyone shooting it being healed for a certain percentage of the damage dealt, and they are slowed if you skill that for 200 bucks, which is quite essential. Just throw this mad milk every time you can. Maybe conserve it when you know that there is a certain wave of robots approaching and there is, for instance, a super scout incoming, and it would be on cooldown if you threw it too early. Just try to time it a little bit right, or just save it for the super scouts if you are really not sure when or where these guys are coming from. Also, and this is quite advanced but should be common sense to be honest, save sometimes this mad milk for a sentry buster that is incoming, so you can slow it down and the medic can rush in with a uber saw and hit the sentry buster for 4 times to get the full uber for his crit streak. This really enhances the whole gameplay, speeds it up and supports your team. Let's now talk about the general loadout as a scout. There are some different opinions about it, but the basic things are always the same, which is the mad milk for the secondary, the fan of war for the melee, and now the primary is really the discussion topic. And I just say what I think personally about it, and I take the shot stop. Let me tell you why. The shot stop gives you a bonus of 20% more healing from all sources when deployed. You get more healing from health kits, and you get especially more healing or more overheal health from money that you pick up, but only when you have the shot stop in your hands, not like sheathed or when your melee is out. You have to hold it in your hands to get this bonus. But the downside is that you get a higher pushback force, which is actually not that bad if you can air strafe good enough to use this pushback as a forward momentum motion that you can use to advantage after that. But that is really not a huge downside because it really never gets you killed. There's no reason to argue that this is a downside actually. I can always transfer this motion that I experience when I'm being pushed back as a somewhat advantage for me, but only not then when there are a bajillion heavies, my team is completely dead and there's no money laying around and I'm being pushed back in a corner, but that would happen anyways if you had any other gun. So the shot stop is my top favorite because you get more health, and what now is my funniest argument, you deal the most damage to tanks. I come to that later, but the shot stop is the best damage to tanks. Let's just lay it down and rest here for a second. Now, why I don't think that the solar popper, the force of nature, the default scatter gun work is that the solar popper makes you jump quite a lot, which is nice, and you can use it as a cooldown if you are not sure if you can get around certain situations. I used that too, but to be fair and to be honest, I really, after I played a lot and had the experience I needed to air strafe, to jump around, to see how the robots are using their threat meter, basically, which they use to detect who to shoot next. And then I figure basically out that I'm being detected by robots. They're basically just looking at you and shooting at you. It's quite easy. But to take advantage of that and really seeing where everything goes before it happens, then you don't need the soda popper anymore. The cooldown really doesn't make that much sense because you have your jump height anyways and you are quite agile as it is. Now, if you take the soda popper, you won't necessarily need the jump height because you are running so fast and moving so fast that you have it always ready basically and can jump around the whole time with the soda popper. With the increased jump height, it doesn't make that much sense, but you can still go for it. It's just my tip. The force of nature is not my choice, because the force of nature has no benefits but maybe pushing back enemies. If there are giant robots, you can't even push them back, you just lift them up for half a second, which doesn't make any difference. A pyro could do way better than you. So force of nature is really no help at all, but it's no downside too. So it's basically, it's not a help in comparison to the short stop, I believe. The default scatter gun also is not my favorite because it has no upsides, considering that there is the short stop. The last two weapons that I did mention were the baby's face blaster and the back scatterer. The baby's face blaster might be used. I mean, every gun can be used, but it's not the best in my opinion. The baby's face blaster can be used, but it doesn't stack up with the running speed. And because you have so much money, and there is so much money that you can pick up, it really makes a difference. You simply go for the movement speed too and have the shot stop and then the advantages of the shot stop with the movement speed, and you have really no loss at all not upgrading the movement speed. It really makes a difference. Some people take the back scatterer. I personally don't like it because you have to be behind enemies, or they don't have to look at you, which is in most occasions really not the occasion. It just don't happen that often that it could matter. Also, if you try to deal damage, there are better ways because you don't have the consistency behind it. If you take the short stop, it will deal way more damage if you do it correctly. So this is basically the upgrade and the weapon choice explanation and tutorial guide that I tried to get across. I hope that was any help. And now I want to proceed to go for some advanced tips that I figured out and not actually figured out, but I was being told and learned by playing. And I really want to get that across because there are some things that you don't normally understand right away. And I really want to get this across. Let's start talking about the Fan O War. Please do me a favor and never upgrade your Fan O War by any means. It is simply wasted money. It's even more wasted money than the fire resistance that I talked about. The Fan O War has a attack speed and can crit and all that, but it really doesn't matter. You can mark only one target for death. Remember that. You can only mark one target for death. If you upgrade attacking speed, you attack faster, but you can't mark more enemies. You just have to press once for the mark, and that's it. There's no reason to have the attack speed. The health on kill, I have never actually seen that, and I'm happy to never have seen that. Don't upgrade that as well. The Fan of War marks one target for death if you hit them. It doesn't matter where, but only hitting them, which means they will receive mini crits for the time they are being marked for death. I believe it's about 15 or 20 seconds they are marked for death, or 10. I don't actually know. But as long as they're marked for death, they receive mini crits, and it is very cool if you can deploy these mini crits on top of these Uber medics or these big medics they are coming. Uber medics, not exactly, because you don't want it to attack the Uber medics because they pop the Uber, and if you pop the Uber accidentally before the demoman can shoot them down at the same time, then you basically missed your point as a scout. I've never seen actually someone popping the Uber with just the Fan of War, but in generally speaking, you want to mark the important targets that has to die first, basically. For example, the big medics, then the other big bots. Also, there's often enough a soldier which has or who has the buff banner, so it's not that bad if you miss out on a target if you are not quick enough, for instance. But just try to get this mark for death on, because if the soldier doesn't have the buff banner active, he always receives mini crits, the target you have just marked. One funny side note here on this exact map, there are three soldier bots on the second wave, and they have all three banners basically represented. They have the buff banner, they have the battalion's backup, and they have the conqueror. Try to mark for death the guy with the battalion's backup. It's just a yellow flag they have on their backs. And if you do that, people tend to shoot the robots more often who have the mark for death sign on top of their heads. Because you mark them, they don't take mini crits because they have the battalion's backup, which denies crits at all. But when it dies first, your mini crits will be enabled again. So try to make that happen just for the team play enhancement, basically. One thing again on this Rottenborg map, there are a lot of spies sometimes. And spy checking is something quite somehow difficult, because there's this big heavy bot with the medic and two medics, I think, in this bag. And you have to kind of survive the spies and get the money from the spies. What I just sometimes do is just stand on top of a rock and try to attract the spy bots, so they shoot me or try just to look at me, and they can't do anything. You just can't snipe them down with your shortstop or whatever gun you're using. Shortstop, please use the shortstop. Now that we've got these somewhat basic things covered, I want to talk about pathing. Pathing is something that you have to consider as a scout. Your only purpose is to take the money. The secondary purposes, which are marking for death and milking people. Oh, that was so wrong. Tossing milk at people or the robots is important too, but it's not vitally important for your team. What do I mean by pathing? It's simply just having in mind the map as a somewhat systematic scheme and just running down the pathways to collect all the money. Don't need to look exactly where the money lies. Sometimes it's very tricky and they lie on the ledge of a rock. And on the slide, it's on the slope there, and it's very difficult to see that, especially where the tank comes from Rottenborg. Or sometimes they hide inside barrels when you're really unlucky. That happens to me once, and there was just like one bug I was missing because it was stuck in the barrel. But when you look around, you basically find everything that is laying around, and you don't even need to find it because you run down the pathways. If you're not sure where to run, just run systematically. First start up where the front is, where every robot is being killed. And if you look down the bottom left-hand corner, you see how much money is laying down. And if the number is green, it indicates that there is money that has not been picked up, but also you are not missing money. If the number or if the symbol is black, it means that you have been missing money in the past, or you have just been missing money, which just disappeared and you will never be able to retrieve it. So just start up at the front to collect the money, just run down systematically, maybe make some loops and just try to memorize where the robots were walking. If you really can't find the money, just run around even more, just find the pathways the robot took and run them down at least once completely. Then if you can't find it, just look at corners, just look at slopes, slides, slips from rocks or whatever kind of material, and then make it happen to grab the money. Just run around. If you don't mark anyone for death for a while, or don't toss milk at anyone, it's no really big concern, because the money is your primary concern. Try to get your priorities right, because I see many scouts dealing damage to tanks, for example, but completely missing out on the money and saying, oh, I was focusing on the money, and clearly they did not. First of all, they did miss 50 bucks. And also I saw as they attacked the tank, 30 bucks were lying around somewhere. All right, just let's talk about the shot stop, which is my favorite weapon for the scout, which is the primary weapon. I have even a professionalized killstreak for it, which I actually quite like. If you want to deal damage with it, the first thing that you upgrade is not the damage, it's not the bullet penetration, it's not the firing speed, it's the clip size. First of all, get the clip size completely upgraded. The clip size basically enables you to shoot more, and because you reload everything at once, you basically reload faster than anyone who reloads bullet by bullet, for example, for a shotgun. But the shot stop is a little bit different there, and you can shoot everything, reload everything, and can, after that, shoot the whole time without ever reloading again, basically. If you are done with that, you go for the firing speed, because the faster you burn through your magazine, the faster you can reload and the faster you deal damage. After you have that, you basically go for the pure damage. You won't need the ammo, because if you know where the ammo packs are or where a dispenser stands, there's no really trouble getting this ammo. You just have to be very cautious, because you burn through these magazines quite fast, which is a good sign. When you have all that covered, you would go for the bullet penetration to get sometimes more than one target, but it's really rare the occasion that even that happens. I would just not recommend doing this damage scout if you're not very familiar with that or not experienced enough before you upgrade resistances. I mean, there is a build supporting the shot stop with a damage scout loadout that you can do and support your team very greatly, but it's very difficult to pull off, and even then I would not generally recommend it. Just go for the money. When everything then is done, you can go for the damage upgrade, which wouldn't be that much, because if you miss money, your upgrades are somewhat messed up because everything like fits perfectly, like for 100%. But now, if there are the three tanks on a Rottenborg map, I just don't remember which one was. When the three tanks come, you can basically wreck everyone in damage. And this is what most people don't believe. I was even almost kicked for that. But just listen up. The short stop with the full damage upgrade, with three crits canteens, with a medic who ubercharges you with crits and then shares the crits canteen with you again. You have basically six crit canteens, and if he's good enough, three ubers straight. If that happens, and if that happened to any other class, you are the one with the best damage. Even if it doesn't happen, I am the one with the best damage to tanks, even though I am 100% scout. The short stop is amazing. It deals like 288 damage per crit shot, and you burn through these 12 shot magazines so quickly. And then I would actually go for ammo capacity as well, so you can shoot more. But when there are also mini crits from a soldier in between, where you don't have crits, then you will just destroy the tanks on your own and no one will even come close to that. Try it out. I mean, it's even good if the scout is not the best DPSer on single targets, but he is very good at it, but only with a short stop. If you go for the scattergun or anything else, it just won't cut it, because they have to reload one by one, and the short stop reloads everything at once. The short stop also shoots faster and has a better consistency. It can also snipe, because the bullet spread is not that great. When you crit, you deal always 100% damage. Doesn't matter how far the distance is, as long as you hit every single bullet. That happens with a short stop. You can stay in safe distance to the tanks, for example, and just snipe it down with crits without ever getting really into close combat with demomen or pyros, and you can always shoot. With a scattergun or with a force engager, you cannot snipe. You always have to be up on close, and it really isn't that much fun, to be honest, and doesn't make sense because it can't deal that much damage. Something now completely different, again to the Fan of War. When there are big bots incoming, and please try to oversee the whole field and look when the bots are incoming, you can actually try to stay at the slope where they basically jump down from, crouch or just stand at this ledge, and then hit them with a Fan of War the moment they are dropping, basically. So when the Demoman has not crit enabled and shoots or lays down the sticky trap, that he at least will get the damage bonus of the mini crits. And this is not vitally important, but it's something that makes you the true pro. Also, if there are medics, always mark the medics first to death or for death, because they have to die first, obviously. Another thing that a scout can do good is to body block enemy robots. For example, big medics, you can try to mad milk only the medics so they are slower and won't catch up with the heavy they are healing, for example. And then you can body block them, basically just standing in front of them, maybe crouching so you're most safe with your movement, but just standing in front of them so they can't pass you. For example, at the little choke point, or when they are dropping from the right top hand side from Rotenborg, they can't really proceed and they are stuck, so everyone can shoot him without he popping uber charge on the big robot he's healing, for example. That is a very great thing. Another thing, when there are two big medics, for instance, and they are healing one another because one of the big bots died or you are body blocking them good enough, they are healing one another and they are impossible to kill, or at least the one who is being healed is impossible to kill as long as the healing beam is there. Try to mark with death the one who is healing, so when he dies, the one being healed can then be killed also. So try to mark with death him, try to focus him with your short stop, and maybe even body block them, or him at least, so you just can get the focus on one done. Two things that I thought were a no-brainer, and I want to quickly add that you have to know. You cannot milk tanks, and you cannot Fan of War tanks. You cannot coat them in milk, and you cannot mark them for death. Do not even try to do that. Do anything but that. You have more important things to do. You can even shoot the tank, and it would be more of a benefit. The other thing is, when you have your movement speed and jump height, which is the first upgrade you should actually go for, you can simply run and jump over robots, airstrafe and jump again and airstrafe again, land somewhere and maybe try take shortcuts and try really to outmaneuver robots, because if they are not super mega, super heavies, they will actually not be able to hit you. You can basically dodge everything, and that is the philosophy behind the scout. You can dodge pretty much everything, and that's why you won't actually necessarily need all resistances up. I would actually do it, but your philosophy is to dodge basically everything, and that is why you need the upgrades for the movement speed and jump height, so you can't do that. So that should be it for the gameplay and the commentary for the tutorial, the guide, or whatever you want to call it. I thank you guys for watching. I hope I didn't forget anything, but if I did, it really is not that important, because It is just a basic and maybe advanced guide. It really doesn't have to cover everything. My intent is to guide rather new, unexperienced or players who just want to have a better overview or some different opinions about a certain topic, and to guide you into this, not just giving you the perfect pro tips, because you need a team to support you as well. I thank you guys again for watching. I hope I could help you, and we see us next time. Keep it up. We'll be right back.